So I'm going to speak in English about the cybersecurity and the view from the lab, the most important problems in cybersecurity as we see it, and the technologies, products, and the main directions, main ideas we are working on. And I'm going to speak about cybersecurity only in terms of the malware, so designed attacks. So the cybersecurity is very wide area. So there's a backups, there are other kinds of the system, of the problems in security. I'm speaking only about the malware, about the code, the machine code, the software which is designed to attack victim systems. So I split all the kinds of attacks of the different kinds of malware in the three categories. First of all, they are not complicated stuff, which is made by non-professional hackers. Targeted attacks, which is made by the very, very sophisticated technologies. They are made by very professional engineers, criminals, and state agencies. And the third, it's about the industrial security, which is the most interesting and the most important the area of cybersecurity at the moment. So, few numbers. By the way, if you want to ask the questions, maybe at the end of my presentation, I'll have there. You have your simple questions, I have the simple answers. Okay, so there are few numbers. Actually, it's the data how much of the malware we collect from the internet. And unfortunately, year by year is growing. So now we collect more than 380,000 new, different kind of malicious code every day. Today, yesterday, well, yesterday it was a Monday, yes, working day, okay. Hackers are, well, criminals, they're humans as well. So we see the little bit decline on the weekends, holidays, Chinese New Year. Right now it's a Chinese New Year, Russian winter holidays, summer, the football cups. Yes, but well, the statistic is that we around the year we collect about 380,000 every day. So the problem is that this number is growing. Unfortunately, the criminal business is still profitable, and unfortunately, there's still there is a gap of opportunity for the bad guys. I don't want to promote the cybercrime for you because it's a risky business, especially when you are in Europe. So the European cyber police and Europol work quite well. So there are many hackers arrested. So don't take it as an opportunity. This opportunity has a risk to be terminated in a jail. But unfortunately, in many other regions, there's still there are a lot of cyber criminals and the new generation of criminals, which develop a lot of malware for Microsoft Windows, for Android, for smartphones, now for Internet of Things. Why not for Mac? Do you know the answer? Not really, because, well, actually, typically the Mac users, they have a little bit more money than, say, Linux users. So I think that, well, I don't know, because I'm not cybercrime, so I don't know, have a direct contacts with these guys. I think the problem is the same like we have. We have not enough of Mac engineers. And actually, even now, we are not looking for Mac engineers, because it's not possible to find such people. We're looking for Linux engineer, and we convert them to Mac. And I think that cyber criminals, they're facing exactly the same problem. They have no one who is able to develop the Mac malware. Windows malware, easy. Android, simple. So I think that this is the reason. Mac is no more safe. It's vulnerable, same way as Microsoft Windows. But I think that this is the reason why Microsoft and Android, it's the main targets of the cybercrime. So, big numbers every day. So what the technical problem here? The problem is to develop automatic systems to process this big data. So different kinds of malware written in different program languages. They could be scripts, could be machine code, any kind of that. So this is a very interesting ongoing task for engineers. I don't call it artificial intelligence because I'm still, in my mind, I have a very conservative, the old definition of artificial intelligence. I call it self-learning or machine learning algorithms. And this is very interesting and very complicated. It's a mathematical task to develop the automatic systems to analyze the machine code automatically, to split clean files and infected. Because I said 380,000 infected, but we collect millions of files every day. And we have to automatically sort out good and bad. And we have a very good team of engineers, and they have a lot of work because the new types of the malware are arriving, so we have this automatic system. And all the time, we need to teach this system. And we have such a big numbers of the new data arriving to the lab, but we process automatically about 99.999% of all the stuff which is coming to the lab. So it's an automatic system which collects the bad data or suspected data from the internet, automatically process it, automatically generate the antidote, the database records, automatically test it and release to our servers, update servers. And this is very interesting task, believe me. So the engineers which are working on that, they're very smart. So it's like when you decide what to do in the future, this is one of the possible vectors of your interest. Automatic systems to analyze their machine code or their malicious machine code. Okay, so that was the first. So this is made by the juniors, well, not so professional criminals, which speak many languages. They speak Chinese, they speak Spanish and Portuguese, mostly from Latin America. They speak Russian, they speak broken English, many of them. They speak it's a number of most of them, they speak Chinese. The second language they speak, it's Spanish and Portuguese, because it's written, when it's written, we don't know how they pronounce it. And sometimes we can't recognize, is it Spanish or Portuguese? Then Russian, broken English, Turkish, and many other, Italian as well, so many other languages. So they are from everywhere around the world. And next category of malicious code, it's a highly professional targeted attacks, which are made by very, very, unfortunately, very smart bad guys, criminals, and espionage state agencies. The numbers are not so big, so we are watching about 100 of projects, because they're projects. So these are team of engineers which developed a highly sophisticated malware. And they do one version, then they develop the new version, and next. They customize these attacks for the specific victims. So that some of them, they don't release the same malware twice. They adapt it for their victim they want to hack. And they are, if they know, so the previous types of crime, these guys, they don't care who you are. If they can't hack you, they will find another victim. So they try 1 million times, and they have thousands of successful attacks, successful hacks. These guys, they want to hack that particular victim. They know the target, and they're not so interested in the other targets. So they will hack again, again, and again until they get through. Unfortunately, these guys, they're able to develop highly professional and unfortunately successful attacks. They do it for Microsoft Windows. they do it for Mac. If the victim use non-Windows systems, they employ engineers which are able to develop Mac attacks. From time to time, we have attacks on iPhones as well, which are protected, but they are vulnerable. They are, so from time to time, there are vulnerabilities, zero-day vulnerabilities. They are very expensive, that these people, they have budget. Who they are? Actually, I split them into two categories. Espionage and cybercrime. Cybercrime is looking for money. Espionage, they are looking for information. Sometimes we can't understand what's that. So we have a new fish, and we don't know what's inside of the fish until we do the research. And then during the research, we recognize, okay, so this particular file, this particular application is looking for the financial information and make some financial transactions. That's crime. Or this particular application is looking for cryptographic keys, is listening to the speaker, is making the snapshots of the screen, looking for some specific files. That's espionage. So who they are? It's very hard to attribute. In a cyberspace, it's very hard to point finger to the, some particular sources of the, these attacks. But we can recognize the language. We can recognize the time zones sometimes. So the most complicated espionage attacks, they speak native English. And they operate during the Atlantic time zone. Maybe Bahamas. Russian, native Russian, operating in Eastern European time zone. Chinese. They are not so active during the Chinese New Year. Right now. but we can point a finger. I can say China, Russia, United States. I can do that because it's very easy, it's very simple to make the false flags, to point a finger to a wrong nation. So again, native English, native Russian, simplified Chinese. And many other languages as well, Italian too. Speaking about cybercrime, which language cybercrime speaks? Highly professional cybercrime speaks Russian only. And there were successful investigations, and there were quite a lot of them, they were arrested. And they are native Russian speakers, citizens of Russia, Ukraine, Baltic countries, citizens of EU as well. They got a lot of money, so they are one of the very first highly professional bank robberies. We call it Carbonac. It was investigated in 2015, 2016, and I think that last year they were finally, all of them, they were arrested. In 2014 and 2015, during 2 years, we estimate that they had about 1 billion euro stolen from bank accounts. 1 billion. So they hacked the bank networks. They step by step, it's not like a bam and you are in. No. They infected the front end computers. Then step by step, without any damage, without any noise, at night when nobody sees, step by step, segment from the network to network, from segment to segment, and getting deeper and deeper and deeper to the bank network. And finally, they were able to manage the bank network remotely. So they created the fake accounts. They were paying the fake salaries. They paying the real salaries to the fake employees and the fake companies. They increased some account in cash. They were releasing cash from ATMs. And they were street criminals employed by hackers to collect cash from ATMs. So the damage we estimate the damage as €1 billion within 2 years. It's a bad news. The good news, they were arrested. So how to protect from this kind of the attacks? It's more complicated task. Because it's not possible to guarantee detection. It's not possible to guarantee protection from this kind of attacks, because they will try again and again and again until you find a breach. By the way, if you want to make pictures, please. And actually, if you want to learn more, so there are links to our webpage. You can collect more information. So they will try again and again and again until they find a breach and until they get into your network. So the main task is how to recognize that someone is in your house. And this is also very interesting, the engineering task, to detect anomalies. Something unusual, something unexpected is going in your network. There are also a lot of the engineering tasks and mathematical. So this is another way how to, if you're looking for your job, if you're looking for the opportunities in a cyber industry, cybersecurity industry, so this is one of the interesting areas for your professional growth. And this is, unfortunately, it's getting more and more complicated. So they are bad guys, they are getting more smart, they have more technical skills. So we have to be more smart there. So we have to not just use the traditional technology to protect the networks, but also to have the detection, this recognize anomalies, recognize that something wrong. Then to investigate it. And sometimes investigation and incident response, it's like a chess game. So there are bad guys on the other side, and they do the tricks how to hide themselves in the cyberspace. And your investigator, it's like we don't read detective stories. We live in detective stories. Well, sometimes our experts, they ask by police, by cyber police, to support them during their physical actions, like the physical arrests. And sometimes they're very funny stories. Sometimes we have a video from the GoPro. So our engineers, our experts, they just follow the police during the arrests. Sometimes, well, nothing interesting, like half a second arrested. But sometimes there are some funny stories. Once they were, one of the cyber criminals that was in Russia, one of the cyber criminals, he were living on the last floor, and cyber police decided to arrest him by going from the roof. You know, that's the ropes, there's heavy ammunition, and they open the window and arrest the guy. And they have to do it in seconds, because they don't want him to lock the computers. They want to keep computers unlocked. Once one of these computers, so the hacker was arrested, but they didn't have enough of skills to investigate. And the computer, which was powered on, was transported from Vladivostok to Moscow. Do you know the distance? Without powering off. So all the time was charged for investigation. So the funny story is that the cyber police, they wanted to arrest him from the roof, and they were waiting for their Friday night. Then the cyber criminal got to the nightclub, got drunk, back home, sleeping, and early in the morning, they were getting down, and the cyber criminal woke up and came to the balcony to smoke. And I like a surprise, he's watching the police, and the police are watching him. We have video of that. Okay. So that was about the highly professional cyber criminals. And this is also, once again, it's a very interesting area for the professional growth. And now it's the most interesting category, industrial security. Cyber systems, they're everywhere around us. This is old building, yeah? So most probably their air conditioning, their fire alarm is still electric. The new systems, they're all cyber. If you have the new building or if you have a new renovation, most probably all their sensors, they have the IP addresses. Most probably the door lockers, they have an IP address as well. It's everywhere around us. Power plants managed by cyber. Power grid, smart grid, must be managed by cyber. Production, transportation. If you have a new car, it's a computer. If you have an old car, maybe you still have this, the handbrake is like, yes? In the new cars, it's a button. So you drive computer, it's a simulator. So there's no physical, mechanical connection from the wheel, from the accelerator or brake. There are no physical, no mechanical connection to the rest of the car. It's a computer. And unfortunately, everything is vulnerable. Internet of things, production, transportation, unfortunately, everything is badly vulnerable. And unfortunately, we see a growing number of attacks on the physical systems. If you remember 9 years ago, this was a report about Stuxnet, the malware which damaged the Iranian nuclear program. So they were physically destroying the centrifuges. How? I don't know. Maybe the resonance. Most probably you don't remember attack on Saudi Aramco in 2011. There was a soft damage. There was no physical destruction. There was just a software wiped on the 30,000 computers, servers, and backups. They lost all the data. Then attacks on some German steel mill. It was a physical damage. 2015, 2016, attacks on Ukrainian power grid, or blackout. Very interesting story. Attribution is, could be very simple. Yes, Russia, of course, yes. But it was a very, very interesting case. So the hackers, they got whole access to the power grid systems. They were able to destroy, physically destroy them. They didn't do that. They made a blackout. They wiped all the software, including their PLCs, but they didn't make any physical damage. Why? I don't know. Well, there is some theories about that, why they didn't kill it. They made this soft damage, like a warning. Well, there are many things which we don't know. And probably we will never know that. But that was very interesting. And actually that was a proof that power grids, they are vulnerable as well. In Ukraine, they had to send engineers to the transformation stations to manually turn it on. I've heard the new systems in Europe, they don't have manual override. So if it happens in Milano, that could be their not so simple case. Okay, so what to do with cyber, with SCADA in industrial environment. This is one more task for engineers, and this is one of the very important, very interesting vectors of our research and developing technologies and products. Security for SCADA, security for Internet of Things, security for SCADA. And this is even more complicated because these systems we have to protect from the junior criminals from the random attacks. If you remember WannaCry, it was a random attack, but it hacked the industrial systems as well. This is Petya, not Petya, many names. Stopped some oil facilities in Siberia, Maersk, and many, some automotive production lines, many of them. It was random attack. Able to destroy, damage, able to damage the technological processes. Professional hackers, you have to protect the system from the professional hackers attacks on the computer networks, and to protect SCADA, to protect the industrial systems from hackers attack as well. Lot of work to do, and every customer, every system, well, I said, well, I'm businessman, so I speak customer. Every factory, every production, they're different. So to protect individuals, your computers, your smartphones, you click, install, and you forget about it. To protect the computer network, download, install, and manage. Simple. To protect industrial environment, you have to adapt your system for the technological processes. So, this is one of the questions which I still don't have an answer, because there have to be so many engineers to protect industrial systems. And there is no nation in the world that has enough of engineers to work with industrial security. So, I'm afraid that if it's going in the same way, so the number of attacks on industrial sector growing with a very high speed, so it will be very high demand on engineers for industrial cybersecurity. So the best engineers in cyber, in industrial sector, will be paid as well as football stars, maybe. And just like a hint for you. Okay, well, but it's just about security. Security doesn't guarantee 100% of safety, yeah? I've never heard about 100% security. So even if you have this system protected, anyway, there is a risk that someone will hack into and make the damage. That's why I speak more and more about not just the security, but cyber immunity. And my definition of cyber immunity is the system is immune if cost of attack is more than possible damage. Negative return on investment. Say if you have a 1 million euro turbine, the attack, successful attack, must cost more than 1 million. Easy logic, yes? Like cryptology. The cost of breaking the code must be more than cost of information. Same. Can we reach it? Yes. And we are working on the secure platform for more than 10 years. We are working on the secure operating system. Yes, please make picture if you want to learn more. It's right here. We are working on a secure operating system, which can guarantee cyber immunity. It has a different architecture. It's not Linux. It's not Microsoft Windows. It's completely different. Well, there are some elements of this operating system. They're already known, like microkernel architecture. It's Unix, for example. But what's very different is that we are bringing the security into the middle of the operating system. The security layer is the most critical part and most important part of the operating system. So we split all the operating system into the micro modules. We split all the applications in the micro modules as well. Every part of the system has the trusted scenarios. It's not sandbox. It's not just signing the model itself. We are monitoring behavior of every piece of the system. Say, if you're a calculator, you don't have access to the internet. If you're a calculator, you have access only to the screen, to the keyboard, to the some necessary resources. If you're a turbine, you don't have access to the keyboard. And all the parts, all the components of the system, they speak to each other only through the security layer. They can't speak directly. So all their behavior and all the information data processing is monitored by a security layer. Does it guarantee immunity? Yes. We can estimate the cost of successful attack. First of all, cryptographic, the keys. If you want to make the more price for the breaking the code, just make it longer. Make it more strict system to monitor the cryptographic stuff. And second way how to hack the system is to hack the developer's computer and inject something into the models which are developed by these guys. Easy solution. After the most critical models are compiled, get them to the clean room and check the machine code and source code. There are even automatic tools for that. Okay, so to hack, in this case, you have to hack developer and the clean room, which is more expensive. Is if not enough, make 5 clean rooms and then go to their dark internet asking hackers, okay, what's the price to hack 6 different systems at the same time? Most probably they are criminals, they say goodbye. It's almost not possible. So in this way we can estimate the price of successful hack. Does it work? Yes. Is it more complicated to develop software for this? Yes, a little bit. Because there are limitation of architecture. So the models, they can't speak to each other. The applications can't do anything which are not in the behavior, the list of trusted behavior. Applications, they must use their very specific API to talk to each other. That's it. The rest is the same. C++, Developer Studio, and go. Do we have their working systems based on this? Yes. It's ready for Internet of Things. It's ready for industrial environment. It's not ready to replace Linux, for example, because it's still a very compact operating system. But it's ready for Internet of Things. So we have already their network equipment, well, not there, it's our partners, the companies which are working, which are developing their network equipment. They have their network switch, network routers based on our immunity platform. There are CCTV, the security cameras. They are one of the districts in Moscow. They made their smart district project with all these sensors that are made on our secure operating system. And there are more. So we're working on that, and this is one of the very, very interesting. Basically, on the picture, we're also working one of the chip makers in Russia. So we plant our security layer into the middle of the chip to guarantee that the rest. So we provide the same architecture, the same idea for chip makers to guarantee that all the components of chip, they're working within the trusted scenarios. So this is one more way of development. So if you're interested in this research, click here. Okay, so we depend on cyber. Cyber is everywhere. Everything is vulnerable. Anything is bad. We will die. There are many bad guys. They are very smart bad guys. But we will survive. We are smarter, and we are, I'm sure we are going into the right way from cyber security to cyber immunity. Grazie mille.